Hi, my name is Amber Middlebrook, and I'm the Director of Education at the Science Mill. We have enjoyed a wonderful partnership with Bamberger Ranch and their amazing staff for the past 6+ years. I personally began working with them for our opening season when Jared and Colleen came and did a presentation, with snakes of course, and discussed with our guests the importance of wildlife conservation and the amazing abilities of these animals. As the museum grew, our partnership with the ranch grew as well, and in 2019, Bamberger was a key component of our Science Outside camp and club program that inspired underserved youth from the Hill Country and beyond to learn about careers related to environmental science. Stephen convinced many of the kids, even one of our own staff members, to overcome their fear of bats and got them to participate in a spectacular bat emergence that opened a whole new world to them. My own stepson had his first overnight in the woods without parents and developed a love for birds that has encouraged him to drop his video games, grab binoculars, and look for birds in our yard and everywhere we go. These students and our staff were transformed by their time at the ranch. They learned not only the story of Bamberger, but took to heart its mission of conservation, education, and land stewardship. All of us at the Science Mill truly value our connection to the vast resource and partner we have in Bamberger Ranch, and we hope that they receive all the support they need to continue their great work for a long time to come. Thank you.
Okay, gather around, folks. I want to tell you a story. A story that's so hard to believe, but 51 years ago, when I bought this property, there wasn't a drop of water on it anywhere. There wasn't even water to drink. So I went out and I spent the money and we drilled 7 water wells. We went 500 foot deep, which is an unheard of distance when most people are telling me their well's only at 210 foot. But over those 7 wells, 500 foot deep, we did not get one drop of water. So the story I'm going to tell you comes about because of 51 years of experience. What I'm going to tell you and show you here today can be duplicated on any property that sits on an aquifer such as ours. And that aquifer is a karst formation. That's what the geologists call it. And it's got a lot of holes in it, but the facts of it are, here on our ranch, it's only 120 foot deep. And after the water that comes out of the heavens goes into this ranch land, it goes through this karst formations, and it goes down taking a circuitous route. It just doesn't go down and then shoot out. It goes down part of the time and then back up and down and up to the sideways and so on. But we discovered something, and that has to do with the most important single thing you can do on your property, and that is to maintain the best grass cover that you can possibly maintain. So when I came here and drilled those 7 water wells, where I'm going to take you in a moment is up on top of these hills. There wasn't any grass. You know why there wasn't any grass? Because there was so much competition from woody species. The primary one in this part of the world was called ash juniper. We all call it cedar. It's really not a cedar. But there's many other wooden species that'll come in and make a home if you abuse your land. How do you abuse your land if you're a landowner? And all of you have bought property up here or you wouldn't be here today. You abuse it by putting too many horses or too many sheep or too many goats or too many cattle, cows on it. You bought 10 acres or you bought 10,000, I don't know. But there's physical limits to what Mother Nature will put up with. So, here's what we discovered. We began to clear all of these tops, and I'm going to confess to you, What I didn't know then, what I know now, I didn't realize, but we began to clear this cedar and clear these tops. And 2.5 years after we began, we noticed green spots, such as this one right here on the hillsides. And you can see some of our work back in there and up here. We walked, there was no roads, it was tangled and was very difficult to get here. But we came up here and discovered dampness all over this little canyon here. It was all damp, it wasn't running water, but the next day we came back with shovels and picks and crowbars and everything imaginable, and we started digging. And we dug a hole about the size of this one that's right behind me. Well, it didn't mean anything that day, but when we came back 24 hours later, voila, we saw what you're seeing right here, a bed of perfect crystal clear fresh water. And as we continued to do this habitat and getting rid of excessive amounts of woody species that were there only because previous owners had too many horses in this particular case. And so, as we cleared, before the summers are over, we had 3 more, quote, springs. They aren't springs. But in this 120 foot that I told you about, there's other geological formations, and there's slabs of pure limestone slabs. So when that water, when that rainfall came and soaked into the land, it went down the 125 foot and it ran into an obstacle and out it goes. Now here's something else. The first rains that came when we did the clearing, we didn't do any good. You know why? I'll tell you why, because there wasn't any grass. Grass has a root system. And once we got grass, and there were certain things we had to do, folks, I'm gonna show you what we had to do. And we still have something to do. We'll never finish, because this kind of work is never done. It's never done. So suddenly, people were getting in touch, and they said, Bamberger, you bought the worst piece of real estate that's in Blanco County. And now it looks like the garden spot of America. I said, you bet it is. Aren't you jealous? Because if you buy something, nobody would buy it. Let me tell you something, folks. You buy something that nobody else wants, it's cheap. It's cheap. That's what recycling is all about in some fashion. But when we learned that water just ran off and learned that we had to have grass, that's what changed everything. Today, folks, we don't have time to show it all to you, but this is only one. We have 11 springs. When they first started to produce water, they weren't springs, they were seeps. But the more of the woody species we got rid of and the more of the grasses we got growing, the more the raindrops fell, only this time they didn't go off. They went into what little bit of soil there is. And these kind of formations in this part of the hill country, and I have to tell you, the scientists, they tell me, Bamberger, you better quit preaching that too much, because you are on a special part of this part of Texas. You are sitting on what we call a perched or local aquifer. Builders and developers don't care much for it because it doesn't hold enough water. You can't build a subdivision on it and expect it to produce enough water. And even these perched aquifers, and I'm going to give you some illustrations of that right now. I'll let you see how it is. I think I will. Yeah, there we go. This sponge represents in miniature that 120 foot. And that 120 foot under this karst condition is sitting with millions of little holes in it, just like this. This is a miniature of this. So we're sitting on top of these aquifers, and as it rains, because we have ample grass, not too many cows, the water falls, and the grass root systems let the water go into the earth. It goes into the earth. It doesn't run off anymore. And a little bit later, I'm going to show you what we've done to assist it from going running. So you got all these raindrops coming. Look at there. Your little perched aquifer is holding on to it. You know why? Because all of these holes are now filled up with water. And then if it keeps on raining or it doesn't rain, we're drawing it down by what we drink and flushing toilets and doing laundry. But the little perched aquifer, whatever rain comes, it can take it. No, here you go. So where is all that water? Where is it? It's there waiting for us to keep us. Oh, dip, boys. Dip the oar, bid farewell to the dusty shore. Freedom ours shall be when we cross the deep blue sea. Now these berms that you're looking at, you can't do it with a bulldozer. You can't do it with any piece of equipment, not even a wheelbarrow. There's only one way you do this, and you reach over and you pick a rock up and you take it halfway this way or halfway that. There's no other way to do it. I wrote a paper for the staff here. I asked them to construct 28 miles of these berms, 28 miles. And not that they had to do every bit of it, but every time we had kids here or adults here on anything, they wanted a project or something to do, hey, come on. I think we did some of that when you were here, didn't we, Jared? So the only thing we have to do with these berms now is wild pigs, deer, armadillos, everything knocks a rock out of the way. But take a look. Look where the dirt is here versus where Jared's standing. Over the period of years, they were not, that water that was running off before the grass was too good was bringing just miniature amounts of soil back. And now then, you can see that grass is prolific here. Why? Because there's a buildup of soil that's been coming off these hills. Now, I had a good time with this, but I want to show you something. Let's walk over here just a little bit. You'll be surprised how many people that come here, adults, that are, boy, they like to play golf. And I always say to them, how many of you play golf? And I always get two, three. I said, well, when you're up there on that tee, and you're getting ready to do something, over there's a little sign. It says, please replace your divot. I say, folks, you ain't playing golf here. Please do not replace your divot. Let me show you why. Every time you pick up a rock, looky here. Now think of the tens of thousands of rocks we've picked up here. And every time you pick up one, look what you have. You have your divot. And the first rains that came, I got these in photographs, I can prove it to you. This place looked like the moon because there was literally hundreds of little divots with just filled with water. We don't have it anymore. You know why? Because they silted in with soil. So that's my story up here. Now then, further up on top here, in addition to the 28 mile of these berms, it called for 8 miles of what I called pans, water pans. And they were just stone dams laid across the place where there had started to be erosion. And we put one every 30, 40 foot, whatever looked would hold. And they too filled up. There's 5 or 6 of them up there. I can't even find them sometime anymore. What I want to send home to you, what I want you to leave here with, is that if you put the respect, you pitch your muscle, this doesn't have anything to do with how much you got in the bank. No, this doesn't cost me one penny. Not a penny. We're doing it all ourselves. And this fall, when it's cooled down a little bit, we'll have guests that are with tours or whatever, and they'll be picking up all of these little rocks that have been pushed away. I don't know how long it'll be, but I won't be around to see it. Theoretically, it's possible that in 100 years you won't be able to see these berms. They're all covered with soil and grass. So I want to take you down again, down to where we are, and show you something very unusual. Let's go. I think the most telling part of this story is what I'm going to show you next. And that's the buildup of water pressure that's in this system. This water and the system that we have hooked up, it's not hooked up, but when we need water in our homes, in our guest house, in our student housing, we can come up here and turn a valve. And it'll take the water away from here, but it'll send it down to the water underground that follows the road. Now, I'm going to do something here that people just, they just cannot believe. And we're all through with mine. Now this opening right here, look at the nice cool water. That's coming from back in here where we dug down 3 foot. And then we put gravel in the 3 foot. Then we put a piece of plastic pipe, drilled a jillion holes in it, and that's there, it's coming through. That plays out, but this one don't. Get a picture of this if you want to see something. That's about as much pressure as you get in a home in the big city. That's all water that's in our local or perched aquifer looking for a way to get out. No, sir, there's no chlorine in this water because all of this karst that it travels through to get here is filtering it just as clean as anything. 49 years ago, I was a little bit scared about drinking this water. And so I'd take a gallon bucket of it to San Antonio with me, took it to a testing lab down there. I want you to test this for me and see if it's safe for drinking. So the man would take it and I'd have to pay for it. I'd come back and get the report. Well, one day I showed up with another gallon of water and I said, I forgot his name, Bill. I need to check this once again. He said, Mr. Bamberger, I don't need to check it. That water's so good, but if you're gonna keep coming back here for me to tell you, bring me 5 gallon, I'll pay you for it. He wanted it to drink. This is better than Ozarka. And when I started at the supermarkets, it was about 15 foot of water where you could buy different kinds. Now it's 60 foot. They're even taken out, and doing a little bit better than soft drinks. So you've just witnessed something. There's no motors, no pressure tanks, no anything like that. But what you've seen today is available in other forms. We just happen to be on this kind of formations, the same kind of formations with this karst. For example, the big Mammoth Cave back in Kentucky, it's all in this. Up at Santa Fe, New Mexico, all of these caves have the same kind of formation in them. We're a little bit different here in that we know exactly how thick ours is, and there's caves all over this country. At any rate, I hope you learned something today that makes this time here at Bamberger Ranch Preserve makes it valuable to you, that you remember it. And I hope you'll take the messages and apply what's fitting on your own property. And also tell your friends where you got it. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Logan Tussey. I'm a geologist from Austin, Texas, and I had the privilege of interning for the Bamberger Ranch about 7 years ago. A lot of my time spent out here was learning about the land and how to treat it and how to appreciate nature. And one of the things I did a lot to pass the time was fly fish. And so we're here at Jacob's Ladder on the Bamberger Ranch, and this is a great fishing location. Today I'm going to just talk a little bit about fly fishing, some of the different basics of how to do it, and some of the basics of how to fish on the ranch and in the Texas Hill Country in general. When I lived out here, I lived a short drive away from this location, so I'd spend the afternoons coming down here after work, tying flies, fishing for the local fish here. And I'd learn throughout the day, working with our biologists, what kinds of small critters I could use to replicate flies for fishing. So crawfish and stoneflies and different small little nymphs that are active in these ecosystems, they make great bait to imitate when you're making flies. And it makes a really great fishing experience when you can replicate something you've seen in nature and execute in the wild. Just to talk about some basics for fly fishing, first thing to focus on are types of flies. There's a wide variety of types of flies. So in here we have these large streamers. These are flies that are going underwater. They're supposed to look like fish and larger prey. And on this smaller box we have dry flies and nymphs. So these are supposed to look like very small insects. The nymphs would be the underwater nymphal phase. And some of these larger ones would be the actual flies themselves. So just so you can get an example of some of the size variations for flies. So they range anywhere from a very large streamer. You might use this on the Texas coast, or you could use it in a setting if you saw a particularly large bass you were going after. This is one of my all-time favorite flies. It's called a clouser minnow. This specific one is actually called the naked lady. It looks clear in the water and it just flashes like a small bait fish. This is a very small fly that would sit on top of the water and look like a small insect that had landed, and you can see those wings potentially. They're very small. And next we have these small nymphs. So this is a small weighted fly that would sit down in the water and look like some sort of nymph insect. And this would be a particularly great fly out here with all the small sunfish and bass and things that primarily really feed underwater. So we're gonna fish with one of these today. Before we do that, let's just talk a little bit about the fly rod itself and fly fishing mechanics. This is a fly rod. This is a fairly lightweight fly rod. This is a three weight. Weights range anywhere from one or two up into the higher numbers that you would use on larger fish. Out here at Bamberger Ranch, the fish, they're smaller. They're not, you know, it's not a huge tarpon or a huge redfish on the coast. So you can use a smaller rod to place more delicate casts and things like that. So a fly rod is fundamentally different than a spinning rod. A spinning rod functions with a reel and a very lightweight line, and there's usually weight at the end of your line. That's a lure or a weighted hook. So all the momentum you're getting to cast is coming from what's at the end of the line. Whereas a fly rod, all of the weight is in the line itself. So as you are casting back and forth, the more line you have out, it is weighting the rod, and it's what's called loading the rod. So the more line that's out will bend the rod further, and that's what's gonna propel your fly forward. And the flies are generally very, very lightweight compared to the weight of the line that is out. So first basics, you just gotta figure out which hand you wanna cast with. That's just personal preference. And once you do that, the major rule in fly casting is that if you were standing on a clock with my body being the center of the clock, you wanna remain between 10 o'clock and 2 o'clock. You don't wanna go all the way to 9 and to 3. You just need to go 10 to 2. So all that motion, it's in a relatively small area, but as you're doing that, your line should be going out and back, and you're loading that rod, and you should be able to get the line further and further, and then you can actually release and present your fly. So we're gonna do a casting demonstration here in a second, but the other big thing to take into account is as you are casting, the real challenge in learning to fly fish is knowing when your line is all the way out. You want your line to go all the way back and reach as far back as it can go before you bring it forward to keep that momentum and to keep the rod loading. So that's a bit of a challenge, but we're gonna try to do it here today. So the spring-fed water out here at Bamberger Ranch is very clear, which is great for fly fishing because a lot of fly fishing employs a method called sight fishing, where you're literally looking for the fish that you wanna catch instead of, you know, kind of blindly casting into a murky pool. So we're gonna do a little casting demo, and then we're gonna look to actually catch a fish. Now, despite how clear the water is, one of the best tools you can have for fly fishing is just a simple pair of polarized sunglasses. So the midday light out here puts a glare on the water, and just by having sunglasses on, it makes sight fishing a lot easier because it cuts the glare off and you can cast to the fish you're actually looking for. So just some casting basics. So once you've chosen the hand you're going to hold the rod with, you're then going to put the fly in your other hand, just remove it from the reel. And remember, we're gonna focus on going from 10 to 2. So 10 o'clock to 2 o'clock. And you can see how that's already moving the line back and forth. So you can let out a little bit of slack with your non-casting hand. And your hand is really the reel. The hand is what's doing all the line maintenance. So you can go 2, 10, to 2, to 10, 2, 10. And it might be hard to see on camera, but I'm trying to let the fly hit the very end of its rope before I jerk it back to the other spot. So as you're going back and forth, you just kind of find a rhythm with that, and you begin to let out line with your non-rod hand. So I'm letting out line with my left hand, and I'm just going back and forth. And this is something that takes practice. I'm not particularly gifted at it, but if I can do it, anyone can do it. So as there's more line out, my rod is bending more, I can go further. So now, you know, we're probably 30 feet out. That's about as long as a cast as anyone needs out here. So when I release this, it'll take the rest of my slack out. And now the fly is in the water and you're gonna simply strip. So this is just called stripping. So I'm pulling about 6 inches of line maybe at the most at once. And I'm just doing that to mimic the motion of a fish. And we have a small fish on. So he's going down in the weeds, but I think we can get him. Looks like a small sunfish. Yep. Come on, buddy. It's a red-breasted sunfish, I believe. I'm not the biologist. I am a simple geologist. So here you go. It's beautiful sunfish from the Bamberger Ranch. Now you can see the sun's out for us now. Put this guy back in the water. Go for a little guy here in a second. Thank you all for joining me today. I hope you learned a little bit about fishing out here on the ranch and fly fishing in general. And come on out and visit. This is a great place to spend some time. Thank you.
Welcome to a really unique spot here on the Bamberger Ranch. Where I'm standing right now is a very unique geological feature. Before I actually talk about the giant fossilized turkey tracks that are right below here, let's talk a little bit about what Texas looked like in about 100 million years ago in the Mid-Cretaceous period. We were under a shallow sea. And if you've ever heard of Enchanted Rock State Natural Area, that is a large granite dome. And that dome actually was a big island called Llano Island. And we were part of that archipelago, that island chain back there. So the ranch was sometimes underwater, sometimes not underwater. So we had this mud flat. Now, I don't know what the dinosaurs called it back then, so we'll just call it a mud flat. Okay? So while these dinosaurs were walking through, something happened. Something happened that froze these tracks in time. We don't know if it was a landslide. We don't think it was a big meteor or anything like that, but maybe it could have been some volcanic activity. But what we have here at elevation 1,800 feet are three-toed dinosaur footprints. The dinosaur that we think made these footprints is the Acrocanthosaurus. Now that sounds really long. Basically that means high-spined lizard, okay? So think of a Spinosaurus, but tinier. And we have three different spots here on the ranch that had the Acrocanthosaurus footprints, or at least what we think are Acrocanthosaurus footprints. And they all occur at elevation 1,800 feet, or around there. So this footprint right here is the original footprint that was discovered. The old road used to come right down through here, and during a rainy day when our manager at the time was going to help some deer hunters, he discovered what looked like, and what he thought, and what turns out to be, a dinosaur print. So Mr. Bamberger went and told him to get a shovel, and they started digging. And what they unearthed was dozens of tracks in this area. And the three spots that we have dinosaur tracks all have dozens and dozens of footprints. It must have been a really important walkway or maybe some nesting grounds. We haven't found any evidence of that, but it doesn't mean it's here. So what you can see are three distinct toe prints. So a three-toed dinosaur like this, which has claws that you can see in each one of these footprints, is called a theropod. So it's a carnivorous dinosaur. And what I also know about this footprint is it's pretty accurate to what the size is. So if I were to stick my size 12 shoe in it, it's larger than a size 12 shoe, okay? So we know this dinosaur was likely bigger than me. Now when we ask the kids what dinosaur it is, we always get velociraptor, because people don't realize that velociraptors are the size of modern day turkeys. But do you know what a velociraptor really is? It's just a distance raptor that breeds with a time raptor. Another reason we know it was a theropod dinosaur, outside of the three toes, clawed feet, and big sharp teeth, is the way it walked. This is the gait of this dinosaur. I don't walk like this. So not only were its feet larger than mine, but you can also tell that it walked a lot differently than I do. Welcome to Mid-Cretaceous Park.
Hey everyone, thanks for joining us here. So where we are right now is another spot on the ranch, also at elevation around 1,800 feet. And so this is the second spot we have on the ranch where we have our Acrocanthosaurus footprints. Now this site has really nice, clear, defined footprints. So I wanted to come here to show you guys some of the teaching tools that we use whenever we're showing the school groups that come out here and talking to them about these footprints. So the first teaching tool I'm going to show you guys is really cool because it's a casting of an actual tooth from an Acrocanthosaurus. Always gets lots of oohs and ahs whenever we pull this out because we're really showing off how this was a carnivore and it had teeth like these for ripping, tearing flesh. Always a really fun thing to pass around, to get your hands on, really get something tangible to hold on to and use this as a teaching tool. Now the second one that I'm going to show you guys is really special to us. This was actually acquired by Margaret Bamberger herself. Now what this is a small piece of fossilized dinosaur leg bone. Now this didn't actually come from an Acrocanthosaurus. Margaret actually got this whenever she was working on a dig site around Fort Worth with Dr. Lou Jacobs.
and she asked him if she could have this small piece of fossilized leg bone from a Paluxosaurus, which we don't have any footprints from Paluxosaurus here on the ranch, but our neighbors on either side of us do. So a really special teaching tool, and also because the Paluxosaurus was a prey animal for the Acrocanthosaurus. So just another really fun, tangible object to get to pass around, and that it ties back to the ranch, and that Margaret got this for us so that we could show it to our programs that come out here to really get them engaged with this aspect that we have here on the ranch. Now the third teaching tool I'll show you guys is another really fun one. So this is a not to scale, not life-size model of what an Acrocanthosaurus would have looked like. Now the reason that we really like this is because it shows how the Acrocanthosaurus got its name. It's showing off that high spine that gives this dinosaur the name high-spined lizard. So really fun to pass around so that you can see what we were really dealing with, how the three toes of this dinosaur looked, and how he was walking around. And then the final one that I'll show you guys, we call our dino floss, not actual dinosaur floss, but we use this because we talk about a nifty little equation that we use out here to measure these footprints. So we know that these footprints belonged to a theropod. And whenever you're dealing with a theropod dinosaur, you can take 4.5 times the length of that footprint to get the hip height. And so what we do is we'll come with our different school groups and we'll measure that out with them. And so I'll say 1, 2, 3, 4, and then 0.5 was our equation to get the hip height of that dinosaur, just to show everybody just how tall this guy was. So I'm 5'10", and the hip height of this dinosaur was over 6 feet tall. So another really fun teaching tool to get everyone engaged and interested and listening to what we're showing them. So yeah, thank you guys for tuning in to see my teaching tools.
That I consider my favorite spot on the entire ranch. We call this our grotto. I can't say it technically it is a grotto, but I guess a better description would be a cave, a karst feature, almost like a cave or a miniature amphitheater. How this area was formed, which likely took thousands of years in the least, is by rainwater flowing over the stone, through the stone, around the stone. And since rainwater is slightly acidic in our limestone here, is basic in reaction. Every time it rains, we have these tiny chemical reactions that takes place where some of the stone becomes dissolved. So, and as you can imagine, that's a process that's very slow. It would take at least thousands of years for something like this to be formed. This is one of our favorite spots for those visitors that can join us here. It's not the easiest location to get to, but we try to bring as many kids groups to this location as we can. It's quite a bit of a hike, and just to get down to this spot, you have to have a little mountain goat in you. But it is well worth the trip. Thank you for joining us at this special location. It is better in person. So, can't make a promise, but come see us and maybe we can get you here.
So, here I am at our archaeological dig site here on the Bamberger Ranch. Now, this is a really special place that we like to bring people, and it's got a really cool story behind it. So, the story behind this place starts with Mr. Bamberger. He didn't actually know that this site was here whenever he bought the property. And the way that he found it is that he came down to this area of the ranch, noticed the nice little creek that's always flowing here in the background, and thought that this would be a really nice place to put a nice kind of log cabin type place to stay on the ranch.
So he came down here and, you know, put a shovel in the ground and started noticing that he was finding a lot of rocks, and eventually he was finding some arrowheads or some remnants of arrowheads. And so he took a step back and said, oh, maybe I shouldn't just come in here and shovel in and, you know, bulldoze the place. He actually called in the state archaeologist at the time, Dr. Arne, had Dr. Arne come out and take a look. And Dr. Arne determined that where we are right now was actually a midden. Now, a midden is just a fancy word for basically a trash site. So this site where we are was used as a trash site by different tribes that would come through this area. And so because of that creek and always having water in it, this was a really great place, and it was used as a seasonal hunting camp. So those tribes that were coming through, like the Comanche and the Apache, would stop here because it was a nice place to have a water source while they were on their hunts. And so during that time, they would take the time to make arrowheads. They also, you'll notice these rocks behind me that have this really dark coloration to them. And that's because they were used in an earth oven. And whenever you repeatedly have fire on these rocks, it gives them that very dark coloration that you can see on these rocks. And so we know that they were stopping here and using this site to eat and to hunt and to rest because of that water source. All right, so I touched on this pile of rocks over here, which is the remnants of what were used as an earth oven. And then I noticed this fairly large piece of limestone, so I thought I'd mention that this is how these rocks started out, and actually quite a bit bigger than this. What the Aboriginals would do is grab a large piece of limestone to line that earth oven with, and then over time and repeated fire and burning, they would start to get this dark coloration, and they would start to fracture and break apart into these smaller pieces. So started with this, and then became what you see here in my right hand with this dark coloration and smaller chipped away pieces. And so whenever we come out here with our different groups that are visiting this site, we actually let them get down in the trenches and start to look around, which is where Jared is right now. Often Jared and I are teaching about this site, and you know, whoever's down here will want to know what they found, and we'll show them what we have and what they found and what it looks like and talk about what it would have been used for. So we don't always get to look for things ourselves. So that's what Jared's in there doing right now. Jared, you having any luck down there finding anything?
Yeah, I found what looks like a scraper.
Scraper.
And some chips. Check back in here in a couple seconds. Maybe I'll actually find something.
Yeah, so Jared mentioned chips. Now what those are the remnants of those worked pieces. So whenever you're creating an arrowhead or spear and you're chipping away at it, those are what's coming off. Those little worked pieces that are chipped away. And that's most of what our groups come out here and find. But whenever we're down here and we have at least...
Got one. Look at this. I promise I did not put that in there before we started filming. This is awesome. So this, if you see that little knock on there, you can actually tell that is what would have gone down into the arrow shaft and then would have had some sinew to tack that down. That is an actual arrowhead. I couldn't plan that any better if I tried.
That's a good one. So before I was interrupted, I was talking to you guys about some of the things that we find out here. Most of what we find, as I said, are chips. Now this is just a piece you can tell that was worked and chipped away, that nice flat surface. Maybe it came off of a spearhead or an arrowhead that someone was working and it got chipped away. So that's most of what we find, are those worked, chipped pieces. But then this is the arrowhead that Jared found. A really good example, because you can see that they were working towards getting that nice triangular shape, and you can see all the little chipped away pieces that came off. Got a nice little notch at the bottom that would have been worked into making that part of the arrow. Here's another cool example. This would have been used as an atlatl point, similar to an arrowhead, but you'll notice it's a little bit longer in shape. A similar kind of V shape with this attempted notch here at the bottom. What else do I have? All right, now another good example. Here we have what would have been used as a scraper. Now this is a cool one, and you'll see how it nicely fits in my hand, because these were used to scrape away the flesh from the hide of a bison. So fits nicely in the hand, and then this edge right here, very sharp, very jagged, good for making that separation. And this one really fits well in my hand. You know, they were made for whoever was going to use it, so that's a nice one. What else do I have? Here looks like maybe an attempted spear, larger, but really getting towards that triangular shape, chipping away. And some of these you'll notice that they're not perfect. Oftentimes you'll find one that looks like they were making a spear and maybe, you know, they messed up or just, you know, they didn't like the feel of it, so they just kind of abandoned it. And you'll have other ones that were clearly worked on for much longer, like this spear.